How have you been since your last visit?
Very good.
Good. People with drug, food, or insect venom allergies stand the greatest chance of suffering from something called anaphylaxis.
Anaphylaxis basically is defined as an allergic reaction which involves two or more organ systems after exposure to a known allergen, or just having low blood pressure after being exposed to an allergen.
Remember, it's histamine release that starts an allergic reaction. And with anaphylaxis, that release can be massive.
Massive histamine release causes marked swelling, both of your airways and your lungs, as well as potentially the airway in your neck. So these patients come in very distressed, unable to catch their breath, wheezing, maybe even blue that they're wheezing so much.
Blood pressure can drop to the point it becomes life-threatening. While this happens to only a tiny fraction of people with allergies, Ed Wilson was one of the unlucky ones. The remedy is an immediate injection of epinephrine.
Epinephrine is also called adrenaline. That does two major things. Number one, it vasoconstricts those arterioles and those blood vessels that aren't maintaining blood pressure. It's a marked vasoconstrictor, so blood pressure is returned. The second important thing it does is decrease the swelling, both in the neck and in the airways.
This is my man bag. My wife gave it to me.
Patients at risk for severe allergic reactions carry EpiPens, portable devices designed to shoot epinephrine directly into their thigh or another muscle during an emergency. Stacy Flasco is fastidious about protecting her son Dominic from future reactions from peanuts.
A lot of people think that just handing Dominic a chocolate chip cookie, even though there's no peanuts in it, that it's okay. But I have to watch for cross-contamination if it's manufactured on equipment that processes peanuts. I don't let him have it. I mean, the odds of him probably having a reaction by that are probably slim, but it's not worth taking the chance.
If I see something with peanuts, I'll just walk away and don't go by that person.
Avoidance of the things that cause trouble is key. In fact, avoidance is the first line of defense against all allergies. But that's just not always possible, especially for the vast majority of allergy sufferers who must contend with microscopic things in the air. Here's where knowing the daily pollen count can be helpful. Pollen counts identify the different types of pollen and rate their presence in the air as high, moderate, or low on any given day. Every weekday morning from April through October, a doctor climbs on the roof of this office complex in South Euclid to take the pollen count for Northeast Ohio.
These plastic rods are what collect the pollen. They're coated with a petroleum jelly-like substance, so it sticks in the air when it spins. And it spins every 10 minutes for a minute for 24 hours.
The rods are taken down to the lab and stained for analysis. Individual grains show up under the microscope and are counted. Many people have a much simpler method to gauge the pollen count. They just look outside.
This time of year is really misery for me. If I did not have medication, I would never be able to stand out here.
It looks like a winter wonderland.
It is. It is. It's crazy. It looks, when you come in, it looks like snow is all over the ground.
Contrary to popular belief, though, this white fluffy stuff floating through the air does not contain pollen. These puffs are actually seedlings from female cottonwood trees, and pollen comes from the male ones at a different time of year. But since the female seedlings usually appear at the same time grass and other kinds of trees release their pollen, they get blamed for lots of misery.
I know, but why does it stop here?
Like most allergy sufferers, Karen Tollefield tried to get by with an array of remedies, including antihistamine drugs. Remember those mast cells that release histamine and get the ball rolling for an allergic response? Well, antihistamines try to block histamine from doing its thing.
You are blocking the development of the symptom. So what happens is the immune response has already started, and what you're trying to do is you're trying to halt it from that point on.
Even with the use of antihistamines, Tollefield's symptoms got worse. Eventually, she sought help from an allergist who recommended skin prick testing. Such tests involve using a variety of methods to place tiny amounts of suspected allergens under the skin.
I'm going to do the test on your back, okay? So we're going to have you lay down here on your belly.
Eric is having a test that uses the equivalent of tiny ink wells to stamp allergens into his back.
When we press the test on, a tiny bit of that allergen goes on just at the beneath the first layer of the skin there. And then that's what's going to cause the reaction.
15 minutes later, the results are in.
For example, this is a positive reaction. So there is swelling, there is redness, and that is a positive reaction.
Okay. Eric tested positive for cats.
This boy, when he is exposed to cat, his eyes start getting watery, itchy, red, and he starts sneezing. So the mother already gave me the history.
So then the test confirms.
The test confirms he is allergic to cat.
Doctors can test for many things that cause allergic reactions, including insect venom, food, and penicillin. But in most cases, it's impractical for people who've not encountered a problem to go get screened for such things in advance. Unfortunately, the way most people find out they're allergic or at risk of anaphylaxis is by having an actual reaction. That's why it's so important to recognize serious symptoms, which can include swelling and trouble breathing. And in the case of bee stings, be like Ed Wilson and tell someone if you get stung so they can be on the lookout for signs of trouble.
Because I knew that it was anaphylaxis, I knew exactly what we needed to do.
Skin test results paved the way for Karen Tollefield to receive so-called immunotherapy, weekly shots tailor-made with mixtures of each allergen found to cause her problems. The idea is to build up tolerance.
We are kind of retraining their immune cells, their T helper cells, to have a different interaction take place so that when the patient is subsequently exposed to whatever they were allergic to, for example, ragweed, the patient then does not have that vigorous allergic response.
Remember the cockroach waste, dust mites, and mold spores, which can all be part of household dust? Well, their purified extracts all end up in vials used for immunotherapy.
We have 10 different molds here. And we also have dust mite, two different dust mites that we treat with because they're different species. This is the cockroach, and it's made out of the waste, rather dark.
There is an alternative to allergy shots that only a tiny fraction of allergy sufferers are aware of. It's tongue drop therapy, which high school swimmer and allergy sufferer Kurt Anderson uses during swimming season.
The drops allow me to practice without soreness, like the shots gave me, and that just really allowed me to practice a lot harder.
The shot felt kind of like a stabbing pain after getting it. I mean, it's felt like almost like a venom in your arm, and you're just pushing it through, and it's hard. It was a lot tougher too. Swim, obviously.
Among other things, the allergen drops Anderson places under his tongue contain dust mites and mold.
It's kind of gross thinking that you're ingesting something you're allergic to, but they add sugar to the substance, so it's not as bad, but it's still not very appetizing.
Tongue drops are not yet FDA approved, so many doctors won't prescribe them, but in Europe, they're commonly used. While Anderson thinks the drops may not be quite as effective for him as shots, they're definitely more convenient because patients can take them at home. Immunotherapy, by definition, carries some risk because patients are taking the very things that cause their allergic reactions. But drops appear to have less of a risk of causing a severe reaction. Even with shots, severe reactions are very uncommon. But as a precaution, patients need to wait for 30 minutes in their physician's office after receiving shots. About 80% of patients who get shots eventually get to the point where they can lower their doses or get rid of their medications altogether. For patients with insect venom allergies, like Ed Wilson, shots are a must.
All right, you're all set.
So what happens is, in the future, if he gets stung by a yellow jacket, his risk of having another life-threatening reaction is at least 50%. So what we can do with allergen immunotherapy is, if we put him on allergy shots, we can decrease that risk to less than 10%. So it is a life-saving therapy.
No matter what the treatment, patients with severe allergies also benefit from making certain lifestyle adjustments. Kurt Anderson's mom does what she can to control dust mites.
I change the sheets every week, wash them in hot water. Not only should you wash the pillowcases and cover the pillows, but as well, I think, replace pillows probably every couple years because of the dust mites that can get in them.
But some allergy sufferers decide they'd rather put up with misery than change.
Oh no, I would never get rid of Daisy Bear. It's not worth it. I'll take my allergy pills, I'll take my inhaler. She's perfect.
Kelly Harrison, for one, refuses to give up the dog she cherishes or the outdoor job she loves.
I like that. What's our PR goal for tomorrow, everyone?
21?
That'd be awesome.
Read, listen, and learn more about allergies by visiting our website at health.wviz.org. There you'll find web-exclusive coverage about the overdiagnosis of food allergies, along with a collection of allergy radio stories and programs from 90.3 WCPN.
Funding for the special health series, Attacking Allergies, comes from the Dr. Donald Goodman and Ruth Weber Goodman Philanthropic Fund of the Cleveland Foundation, the Mount Sinai Healthcare Foundation, the Margaret Clark Morgan Foundation, the McGregor Foundation, St. Luke's Foundation, the Sisters of Charity Foundation of Cleveland, the Woodruff Foundation, and the Kaiser Foundation Health Plan of Ohio.